You've said the war is against Hamas, not against the Palestinian people. But you have also, I'm sure you've heard of experts, those, I mean, leaders also from other, from all over the world saying, is Israel's actions, is this still a matter of self-defense? You have the Palestinian ambassador who was also on Head Start who said, Israel's actions is now bordering on genocide, war crimes. In other words, the reaction of Israel is now the discussion worldwide.
Let's remember September 11, okay? Let's think about a government which its own citizens are being attacked in such scale. A responsible government has to give protection to its own people. And this is what we are doing now. Our measures, we are targeting Hamas. We are informing civilians, even before attacks, keep away from Hamas infrastructure and Hamas facilities. Now we know that the facilities of the Hamas are inside mosques, are inside hospitals, are within residential buildings, and we even the residents of such a building will get an SMS or a phone call from the IDF telling them evacuate because in a few hours we are going to attack this building, meaning we are taking away the element of surprise, so the Hamas knows, but we are taking all measures to avoid having civilians affected by the Israeli attacks. Of course, it's a war. In any war, and you see pictures of war, you know this very well, people affected on both sides. We are doing our best to minimize, and this is what we have to do. We also informed the citizens of Gaza, move away from the northern part of Gaza, which is a main concentration of Hamas facilities, move to the southern part of Gaza to be safe. And what is the Hamas doing? The Hamas send the messages, stay here, stay with us, don't go to the south. And we have even footage of the Hamas blocking roads leading from northern Gaza to southern Gaza, meaning they are using human shield, which is a war crime. This is not what Israel is doing. And for me, the most, I think, significant sentence is, Israel is using its missiles to protect its citizens. The Hamas is using its citizens to protect its missiles. That's the difference between Israel and the Hamas.
Mm. All right. Now, the latest death toll that we have, I'm just going to read this now in terms of the latest that's come in. The Palestinian death toll is at 4,600. Israel is 1,400. Every life matters. Let's talk about the hospital bombing. So it took on a new life when the hospital was bombed in Gaza. There's information that's come out that it wasn't a missile coming from Israel, but it was a missile coming from the northern part of Gaza. And the missile actually, well, I'm not an expert, but something went wrong. It turned around. But it's not been established yet that the bombing of the hospital and that particular missile is connected with each other.
Karen, I have to say that I'm very disturbed because Israel, as a responsible government, waited before it responded to the claims of the Hamas that Israel bombed this hospital. And we investigated. Two and a half hours later, we came with very clear footage, voice recording between Islamic Jihad and Hamas operatives that this was an Islamic Jihad failed launch of a rocket. So this internal information, this footage, President Biden announced it when he visited Israel, which was very important. And today, the government of Canada also announced very clearly they have all the evidence to say that this hospital was basically a target, unfortunately, of a failed launch of an Islamic Jihad rocket. And this is exactly what we're saying. They are using their own citizens and the civilians to protect themselves, and are firing within the city. So this, I think, is a responsibility. I would say it was not responsible by a lot of the international media, not all, but a lot of international media did say that this is only a claim of Hamas. And I believe it is a responsibility of the international media to come up to say the truth, and the truth is that this was a result of Islamic Jihad. But let me add another point. Nobody has mentioned that Israeli hospital called Barzilai in Ashkelon,
which is the southern part
of Israel, which was a target of a few attacks of Hamas missiles who hit the hospital. But I wonder why.
Yeah, that wasn't really, there's no coverage.
No, in Israel there is coverage. How come the international media is not covering this? Because Israel is being attacked every day, every day. And yesterday I think there were 55 missiles and rockets launched against Israel. This is not reported anymore.
Why do you think that is?
Because,
which is quite interesting, because it's true. If you do watch international media and international organizations, there is a big focus on civilians in Gaza.
Karen, I think there is, number one, some kind of an agenda to keep the Palestinians in their own situation as the underdog, and people like to identify themselves with the underdog. Israel, as a responsible, democratic, liberal country, is not focusing on wars and on the past. We are trying to develop Israel, Israeli economy, Israeli society, to move away from the wars, to move away from being a target, and we want to build our future. And our future is connected to the world. And we are sharing innovations, technologies, a lot of know-how coming from Israel with the world to embetter Israel and to embetter the world. Now, world media is biased against Israel. It's historically, it's not new. So why didn't Barzilai Hospital, the bombing of Barzilai Hospital, was not mentioned in the media? Why do they forget that until today, Tel Aviv and people who live in Tel Aviv, including my family in some places, they have to go in safety rooms or into shelters? Somehow this is forgotten. Israel, in October 7, was attacked. Secondly, we have to remember we are surrounded, or we are staying in a hostile environment. And you see the axis of evil, which is trying to destroy the state of Israel. We are the ones that are under threat continuously since the establishment of the state of Israel. And what's happening today? Even missiles sent from Yemen, probably targeting Israel. Hezbollah, northern border of Israel, is controlling southern Lebanon. It is assisted, same as Hamas, it is assisted by Iran in ideology, in training, in weapons, in financing, and we have all the evidence. They have already launched, not yet a full-scale war, thank God, and we're saying we do not want to have a full-scale war. But tens of thousands of Israelis have been evacuated from the northern part of Israel into the center because of continuing attacks by Hezbollah. And it's increasing every day. And Israel has to protect itself. Did you know that there are more than 120,000 Israelis that are internal refugees that had to move out of their homes? Some of them cannot go back because they're all totally burned and destroyed, but some because it's continuously under attack. And the Israeli government is taking care of them, of course. But there are many facts about Israel that are not really known to the world. And I think it's important that people would understand the situation.
So you brought out biases against Israel that's been going on for years, generations, decades. You brought that up today. And you claim even with the international media. But could this be the other side, is the reckoning, the calling for accountability with Israel, when frankly, after the UN convention, Israel still militarily occupies the West Bank. And yes, you've left Gaza in 2005, but it's been described as the biggest prison on earth, wherein Palestinians, in effect, still don't have their own nation for self-determination and independence. Some say that, frankly, Hamas is the result of decades and years of fighting for self-determination. I'm not justifying Hamas, but let's talk about that side.
For me, I understand the historical question, but I would say two things. Number one, let's remember the facts. The facts are that on October 7, Israel was attacked by a terror organization called Hamas in the most horrific attack targeting civilians. You see the war plans. They have plans, and we have all the evidence, and the plans were to target civilians and to kidnap them, as many as possible, to Gaza. About the political situation with the Palestinians, of course, the end is to find a settlement. However, you have to remember that 1948, when Israel was established, the same day Israel was attacked by the Arab countries around, they were so sure and confident that
the
within
Six-Day War.
The Independence War. Later on came the Six-Day War in 1967, then Yom Kippur in 1973. There's so many wars.
I'm familiar.
You ask yourself, why are there so many wars? And the answer is because the Arab world, now it's changing. Soon I'll say a word on that. But the Arab world, since 1948, is trying to destroy the State of Israel. State of Israel is the homeland for the Jews. And as homeland for the Jews, we have nowhere to go. And that's our power and that's our weakness. Meaning, if we will be losing any war, we have nowhere to go. They will massacre us. So this is our only place. The Philippines is a country to stay. Everybody recognizes the Philippines. Israel until today is a target. And Iran, Hezbollah, Hamas, Syria, Lebanon. Thank God the Middle East now, today, is not the same as it was then. Even Egypt and Jordan have signed peace treaties with Israel. As you know, Gulf countries, United Arab Emirates and Bahrain, we have full diplomatic relations with Morocco. This is only bringing benefit. So I would say it's about time for the entire Arab and Muslim world to move to the next stage, which is, first of all, recognizing the right of Israel to stay, to exist, and for the Israelis to be there. Secondly, it's time for the Palestinians to say clearly, we recognize the right of the State of Israel to stay. Let's move to a political process. What happens is that time again and again, they move to the first intifada. Intifada is an uprising, a violent uprising targeting civilians. Then they had the second intifada. In the last few months, there were so many terror attacks, not on the same scale. One, two, three, four, five Israelis killed. A country cannot allow itself. Let terror groups attack its own civilians, and we have to protect ourselves. And this is what we're doing. The Hamas cells, Islamic Jihad cells in the West Bank. Regarding Gaza, we pulled out of Gaza. We are not controlling Gaza. There is a Hamas government in Gaza. They are deciding what to do. They are channeling the funding and the resources to arm themselves and to build themselves to this attack. This started a long time ago. Israel is supplying water, not all the water, by the way. A lot of water is supplying locally, and we are supporting the establishment of water desalination. We are helping in building more power, local power generation. We are employing Palestinians from Gaza in Israel. More than 20,000 Palestinians until October 7 were employed with Israel, and we are trying to increase the number. And one of the Israeli local leaders in one of the municipalities there who was murdered by Hamas was the one initiating more economic projects in order to have better neighborhood relationship and to increase the standard of living in Gaza. A lot of projects were taking into consideration the security aspect. But what did Hamas do with this project? It built itself and is preparing for launching attacks against Israel, because Hamas is a religious political entity which is calling for the destruction of the State of Israel and establishing an Islamic state. It is part of ISIS. It's a global part of a global trend or global movement establishing Islamic states, if it is in Iraq, if it is in Syria, and of course against Israel. By the way, we had ISIS operatives in the Philippines, as you know very well, and even Hamas operatives and we have two cases came out in the media just the other week of two Hamas operatives in the Philippines. So Israel is not the only country who is facing this, but for us, we have nowhere to go.
Israel Prime Minister Netanyahu told troops, as you've heard there, we are in for the battle of our lives. This is a war against Hamas. It is do or die. And I recently saw a clip, though, coming from the Israeli president. I believe, and he blamed, in that clip, he was speaking to the Israeli press, he blamed not just Hamas, but in a way, a whole nation. Those were his words. I don't know if you've seen that clip. He said the whole nation, as he says, they voted for Hamas. They put them in power. They did not protest against Hamas when Hamas staged a coup. They didn't do that. So in a way, he blamed the whole nation. Let's move towards that. Is this really a war just against Hamas? Or frankly, it's to wipe out the Palestinians in Gaza and for Israel to come back and take over Gaza?
Karen, I think it's important to say it loud and clear. This is a war against Hamas. This is not a war against Palestinians, it's a war against Hamas. Yes, the Palestinians have voted and elected Hamas. When Hamas took over, I don't know if you remember the pictures, they murdered the representatives of the Palestinian Authority who were controlling Gaza until then, their own brothers, they murdered them, okay? Hamas is a social Islamic organization working through social networks, economic benefits, and building the military capability to, in order to destroy the state of Israel. So when he said about the whole of nation, it's not what we want to wipe Gaza off the map. Israelis are not cruel, you know, we want peace. We want to live, we want our children to live and not to die and not to serve the military as we have to until today. And we want the Palestinians to have better life. We are supplying water. We are supplying jobs for the Palestinians. They are working in our homes. We are initiating economic development projects, fishing rights, Gaza Marine, which is exploration of gas in the Mediterranean next to Gaza. All kinds of projects that we are trying to initiate to help the Palestinians. Now, the Palestinians have elected a Hamas government. It was their decision. We cannot help it, but we have to deal with this government. This government is most important document says that they have to destroy Israel. So until October 7, we were trying to find ways to live with them in a, I would say, they don't have a political agreement. We have some kind of a ceasefire, that you would say. But as you saw, in October 7, they launched the war. We have to protect ourselves. Now, about the people, I want you to imagine, if you are sitting in your own house, your children in front of you, comes a terrorist and wants to kill you and your children, and the terrorist has his children in front of him. What do you do? You say, okay, shoot me and my children, or do you shoot back before he shoots you, even though he has his children in front of him? This is a terrible, terrible situation of decision-making, and here there was no decision-making. We had to respond, to retaliate, and basically the goal of this war is, number one, to return the Israeli hostages, and probably they're not all of them Israelis, by the way. And we have no discrimination, and we don't make any distinction between Israelis and non-Israelis. There's still two Filipinos missing. So we want to bring them back.
Is there information that there are Filipino hostages?
We don't know. No, we don't know. There are two missing Filipinos. There's still Israeli missing. We know they have more than 213 captured. We don't know the exact number yet. It's all coming as from footage. So we don't know, but I'm saying we know that there are a lot of foreigners, and yesterday, the other day, as two Americans were released, but they have captives of different nationalities, and we'll do our best, number one, to bring them back home, number two, to make sure Hamas cannot launch a war against Israel once again. It's against Hamas facilities and infrastructure of terrorism. The people of the Palestinian people have all the right to stay. We're not going to, I mean, we cannot send them away. I mean, this is not who we are. I'm quite shocked that this is what is discussed in the international media or in different social media. This is not the purpose of the war. We have no war with the Palestinian people.
All right. Now, let's talk about first, four Filipinos have been murdered. What is right now, I mean, I know that Filipinos living in Israel don't even want to come home. I mean, it's happened before. They want to stay in Israel. They're quite happy in Israel. There have been appeals already for Filipinas married to Gazans to actually want to leave the area. But those stay in Israel. What's the state today?
So we have, we estimate about 30,000 Filipinos staying in Israel. We know that some, very, very few, came back in the last few days. Four have been murdered in this attack on October 7. One, I think only one was injured, and he's lying in a hospital in bed next to my nephew, who is a soldier, and he was injured in this war. And they are getting exactly the same treatment. The Filipinos in Israel are part of us. They live with our own people. My father-in-law, who is 93 years old and Holocaust survivor, he has a Filipina staying with him. So they are part of our families. They are staying in our homes. When we have to go into a sheltered room or into
a bomb shelter
or safety room, they come with us. So the Filipinos who were murdered, one of them was in the beach party. Unfortunately, the Hamas butchered more than 230 Israelis celebrating on the beach on that night, unfortunately. So one Filipino was murdered there, and three were murdered because they stayed with their patients. And that's something very important to really for us to recognize and to appreciate, that the Filipinos are part of us, and you are part of us, we are part of you. And they stayed with them even though they realized that it's going to be so dangerous, they stayed. And I want to, it's an opportunity for me to express my sympathy, my condolences to the families and our appreciation. You are now joining the Israeli family, which is a big family, unfortunately, of the victims of terror. And we are taking care of you as one of our big family in all different kinds of ways. Mm. The 30,000 Filipinos, most of them feel that they are safe and they want to stay exactly for that reason, because they are part of us.
All right. Now, I want to move on to the bigger concern worldwide, that this might turn out to be a wider conflict. So we understand, of course, geopolitically and historically, but where are you seeing? So the United States and the Israeli Prime Minister has warned against, of course, Lebanon, Syria. And by the way, just for the audience, Israel has also attacked Syria. We're in parts of Damascus and Aleppo. Let's talk about that. We're hit. So the action of Israel, how far is it going? What is the extent?
So there were reports about Israeli preventive attacks in Syria lately, but let me start with the borders, mostly the border of Lebanon. Hezbollah is controlling the border of Lebanon, not the Lebanese army. Hezbollah is launching different kind of attacks, including terrorists who are entering into Israel, including firing of rockets into Israel, mortar, different kind of weapons. And Israel is defending itself, mm-hmm. of course, but we would not want to see a full-scale war mm-hmm. on the northern part of Israel.
Yeah.
A few terror groups from Syria have tried to attack. It is better contained. What is the big challenge here? Mm. And that's important to understand. Hamas, Hezbollah, Islamic Jihad, they are all proxies and get all the support from Iran.
Yeah.
And Iran weapons are coming through mostly at Iraq, Syria, Lebanon to Hezbollah, through the sea to Hamas, through international aid to Hamas. And we have evidence.
Even
Hamas
through international aid?
Through international aid to Hamas. We have evidence. Last week, the Hamas broke into warehouses of one of the humanitarian organizations in Gaza, yeah. And took medical supplies and took gas for their own use. Instead of letting it to be used as humanitarian assistance, they took it over for their own use, for their own people. We have evidence. When they attacked Israel, we saw vehicles and support of UNICEF, which was used. We saw sacks of never mind what country being used for the building of the bunkers of Hamas. So the different kinds of way how they can use international humanitarian assistance, and we're saying we have no problem with humanitarian assistance, to come, but we're moving away.
Yeah.
Let me just say,
we
saw
a but clearly missile. That's not sanctioned by the UN. For them to be using UNICEF,
they're not supposed to. But what is the UN doing in order to prevent it? This is why we're saying we have no problem. We're not objecting to humanitarian assistance coming into Gaza as long as it doesn't fall to the hands of Hamas. It's serving only the civilians in Gaza, and it has to have food, water, medical supplies, and energy. These are the most basic needs. We have no objection concerning that.
Now, the United Nations is calling for a ceasefire, a humanitarian ceasefire. And yet, you have Israel strengthening the attacks, moving on to the next stage.
Well, we have been saying that for the last, we are preparing ourselves for the next stage since October 7 until we are ready. And of course, every day brings us closer. I don't have the exact war plans, but we are very close.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let me just say on the international side, Iran is trying to cause, to create a regional war. Mm. This is why they're pushing more weapons. And you can see even the Houthis from Yemen trying to launch missiles against Israel.
So, okay. Now, Iran recently warned Israel and the United States, and Iran said that the Middle East may spiral, that's the words, the spiral out of control if Israel does not immediately stop military action.
Well, with all due respect to Iran, Hamas has launched a war, and Hamas is continuing to fight against Israel, is not releasing the hostages which it has kidnapped, continuing the launching of missiles and rockets. So with all due respect, what do you hear from the other leaders of the world? President Biden, Prime Minister of Italy, Prime Minister of the UK, Chancellor of Germany, other world leaders, many foreign ministers who came to Israel and are expressing unity in Israel's right to protect its own citizens. So with all due respect to Iran, who is sponsoring terrorism, who is sponsoring violence, who is developing a nuclear program, which is supposed to be a military program, and who would be the target at the end of the day? It's Israel. So with all due respect to Iran, it's about time for the international community to restrain Iran, to put more sanctions on Iran in order to have the region safer and not to have these terror organizations getting more and more armament and supplies from Iran. So Iran is a problem. It's not a solution in our region. Look what happened with UAE and with Bahrain. We have full diplomatic relations with Egypt, with Jordan. Mm. Suddenly, things are more calm. It makes sense to move to a diplomatic process of mutual recognition and respect. So this is what we are calling for the long term. Immediately now, number one goal is not to have any more facilities and terror infrastructure which will be targeting Israeli civilians.
Mm. All right. Now, Ambassador, I think the last words is moving forward. Is this the only solution? It's very difficult because you are an ambassador, and clearly you are, you'd have to take on the train of where the leadership of Israel stands. But the world is asking, is this the only solution? Yes, Israel has a right to defend itself, clearly. But in the years to come, is this the only way? Or is Israel open to moving to a dialogue? I mean, at one point during the time of former US President Bill Clinton, it was historic. It was believed that there was peace brokered, right? Between Israel and the Palestinian people. If I remember correctly, it was Yasser Arafat and Yitzhak Rabin. Mm-hmm. Is my memory correct?
Yes.
Yeah. And I've been to Israel. I love the people. I mean, spiritually, historically, it's quite rich. I've also been to the West Bank. So I've seen both sides. And that's, I think, what the world is asking now. Is this the only way?
So clearly the answer is not. We have the immediate, and that's, we are in a war, and we expect the international community, and we get also the support from the Philippines, I have to say, in this war, terror war against Israel. We have the responsibility to protect ourselves, and I think we're getting very strong, clear international support on that. obviously, for the long run, it's something that we have to negotiate. And as I said before, the Abraham Accords changed the region. For me, it was a dream come true because I was part of the very quiet efforts of the State of Israel to establish relations with the Gulf.
Yeah.
I was lucky to be part of it in a very quiet way. And
in the 90s, this is the 90s.
We started this, the operation itself was, in the 90s we started with the Oslo process, which brought a lot of hopes. Today, unfortunately, what we say is about the Palestinians, especially Yasser Arafat and Abu Mazen, who is the current leader, that they don't miss any opportunity to miss an opportunity. Because they were offered a lot of solutions by President Clinton, who put a lot of pressure on Yasser Arafat. There was one very important proposal that passed even the Israeli cabinet. This was in 2000, passed the Israeli cabinet. The Palestinian side, no response. Basically, not saying anything means saying no, unfortunately. So there were a lot of different proposals. Unfortunately, as long as we don't have a partner for peace, how can we create peace? That's our challenge. The Palestinians voted in Gaza for Hamas. How can we have peace when you have a government there who is calling for the destruction of the State of Israel with an Islamist ideology? And I'm not saying all Islam is extreme. This is the Muslim Brotherhood, we have to remember. So it's not all the Muslims. But they have an ideology driven out of the Muslim Brotherhood, of the ISIS, calling for the destruction of the State of Israel. So very difficult to talk about the political process with them. And what I would suggest is ask them, are they willing to enter into a political process with Israel? Currently, no. At least I'm talking about the Hamas. For the long term, I do think opening up the region, establishing diplomatic relations, establishing people-to-people relations, and there are a lot of initiatives of people-to-people. Now there is nothing. Long term, this is what we have to do. Absolutely. In Israel, the Jewish people have prayers, and our prayer ends with a prayer for peace, always. We end our prayers for peace. We have to remember that the Jews have been attacked for centuries. This is just the last one, not only the wars, but is of course the Holocaust, with an attempt to destroy the entire Jewish nation. Even though we have been targeted of so many persecutions and so many of our people in the Holocaust, one third of the Jewish nation was murdered because they were Jewish. Even so, we end our prayers with a prayer for peace. And today we end our prayers every day with a prayer of peace for the State of Israel, meaning we want to have peace. To have peace, we need to have somebody responsible, reliable, and committed to peace to negotiate it together.
All right, on that note, I want to thank you for coming to Head Start. I do hope we speak together again. Ambassador Ilan Fluss, Israeli ambassador to the Philippines.